Get ready.
Hashtag Team Fibro.
Reloaded.
Hello, everybody. Kristal here at the Fibromyalgia Pain Chronicles and Veteran Voices for Fibromyalgia, bringing you another informational video that I hope you'll find beneficial and helpful. And joining me today is Joy Lenz, who is a certified dietitian and registered dietitian, the founder of Bring Joy to Your Kitchen. And she's very passionate about utilizing foods, especially plant-based diets, to emote positive changes and positively impact our overall health. So Joy, thank you so much. I know you're so busy today, and I appreciate you taking the time to meet with me to discuss this topic. How are you?
Hey, very good. Thank you. Thank you for inviting me on as a guest. I'm so happy to be here.
Well, I am too, because I love talking about nutrition. And while I have some base knowledge on certain things, I get a lot of questions from the community, because with fibromyalgia, we often end up developing a lot of secondary or coexisting medical conditions. And sometimes it's hard to navigate that nutritional kind of like quotient of like, what foods to stay away from, or if we're on a tight budget, what would be a more impactful like food choice to make sure we're getting the extra like vitamins, antioxidants, and promoting our overall health within our budget. And you're one of the experts on understanding and knowing how all like plants, like fruits and vegetables really work within our body. And that's why I asked you to join me. So, you know, with that said, what are some simple nutritional modifications that we can all use to emote positive impact on one's health?
Yes. Okay. And you are so right. And I think too, one of the frustrating things, Kristal, is that there's so much misinformation out there, isn't there? There's just constant messages. And at some point then people just don't know what to believe anymore. Mm-hmm. But today, yes, I have seven simple nutrition modifications or things to think about that will help improve one's health. And the first one that I'm starting out with is preparation beats motivation any day. And what I mean by that is simply, to the degree that you're able, I always encourage my clients to plan or, you know, write down at least a meal or two, or maybe a day or two or 3 days of what you're going to be eating. And that way, when you go to the store, you have more of a plan, you'll purchase the things that will help you be successful, and you'll be less tempted to eat the things that maybe you don't want to be eating. But planning ahead, and then therefore having the ingredients and the foods on hand, is going to be the very first step. So preparation beats motivation, because when your motivation isn't there, and if you don't have the items on hand, it's really going to be hard. But if you have planned ahead and you have the healthier, nutritious things on hand, you're going to be more likely to be successful. So that's number one. Number two, I am a big proponent of breakfast. And, you know, it's our first meal of the day, so we really want to start out on a good note. And I definitely recommend more, I'm going to say, whole plant foods that are not so processed. To me, one of the simplest ones is a bowl of oatmeal and then load it up with berries. And then I'm going to get to later on here, but maybe like hemp seeds or flax seeds. And even coconut, you can do any fruit on top of oatmeal for that matter. Maybe a piece of whole grain toast. And now, you know, it's really popular to do avocado toast, or even just a nut butter, like almond butter and bananas. So just kind of simply plant kind of foods at breakfast, but and not so processed. But I think breakfast is really important. Oh, and I love smoothies as well. It's a great way to get in greens and fruit, maybe a plant milk. And then sometimes, again, I would kind of put in some of the seeds as well, like flax seeds or hemp seeds.
Right. I do, like, when I'm having some flare days or my stomach's kind of like, meh, I do the fruit smoothies. I have like a little bullet that's like a single serving that I can actually just drink out of the, you know, container that I make it in. And I will get the organic frozen fruits, like your blackberries, your strawberries, because, well, it makes the protein shake or, you know, the smoothie look pretty, but they're chock full of more vitamins, minerals, and antioxidants compared to lighter color fruits. And then sometimes I'll throw spinach in there, and then I add an organic non-GMO preservative free. It's like a chickpea powder.
Okay.
Plant-based powder that has like chia and all that fun stuff that I can't pronounce. What's the one that starts with Q? Can't pronounce that one. Quina?
I don't know.
So I'll throw the scoop in there, and I use coconut milk.
Okay. Yeah.
Also, it thickens really nice. It's with the frozen fruit, protein powder, plant-based protein powder, and then I have a meal and all my nutrients for the day. And like I said, that's kind of one of my chronic illness hacks when I don't feel well or my hands are really hurting because of arthritis and it's not going to work to manually make anything. And I want to make sure I'm getting everything I need. That's one of my go-tos.
Yep. It is. It's fun to make a smoothie and see how many different plants or different kind of things you can get into it. It's really kind of fun. Great. And yeah, like the berries, like you said, even just mixed berries can get in lots of different variety as well. And I have a daughter, she literally takes her smoothie right from the blender, puts on the lid and takes it out the door every morning. So just like you, those single serving cups, those are good. Those are good to take it to go. Yep.
Yeah. So, and you can get those type of things very inexpensively now, where back in the day they were expensive, but like I found mine at a store that is called Big Lots and it was $15. One of the best $15 investment I ever made. So
yeah. Yeah, that's good. That's good. All right. Number three for the just simple nutrition modifications, that my recommendation would be to cut back or just really become way more mindful about the snacking habits. And if processed foods are specifically are sneaking in at different meals or in between that, I really would like people to not have so much processed foods and to not have so much snacking if possible. My goal would be to help people get more significant meals so then they don't have to be snacking in between meals. If they are snacking, then get whole fruit or vegetables, like vegetables with a little hummus or fruit with some nut butter, stuff like that. So more whole foods instead of processed snacks.
I think that a lot of times people don't understand like processed foods. And I'm like, if it's anything taken from its original state and kind of turned into something else, it's processed. Even like beef and you grind it, it becomes processed because it changes the protein molecular structure and it actually makes it harder for you to digest. But there's a lot of staple food products that people include in their meals that are technically processed that we might not think are processed. Can you think of some ideas? I know sometimes like some people like macaroni and cheese, even when they buy the organic, it's still processed because of the cheese, even though you're adding milk, but the cheese is usually powder or kind of like creamy. And so that's processed. What are some other common staples that are processed foods that people add, like sometimes as a side to a meal or?
I think what you're kind of referring to is like the pastas and just different things that come in a box, I guess, you know? So maybe different, what else am I thinking? it may be instant potatoes. I mean, those are really economical. But I would recommend trying to get more of the real potatoes. You know, all the different cereals. We kind of tend to think cereals are okay, but they are really heavily processed and a lot of fiber has been depleted. There, many things are depleted. So just all the different things that come in boxes, I guess, is kind of what I'm thinking. Okay.
I never thought about that with cereal.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of good cereals too, where the fiber is still good. And I would recommend, you know, like the shredded wheats or, you know, different cereals that have more of the, or flakes, the bran flakes or something that has more fiber.
Gotcha.
But I'm just, when I say more, less processed foods, I am thinking more about all those things that you would maybe find at a gas station.
Granola
bars and chips and, you know, just different things that are the typical person in America is snacking on. You know, maybe it's available at the office or in our pantry. It's, you know, maybe something that our kids eat and we think we're not going to eat it, but then we do. You know, chips is a big one. So those kind of processed snack foods, that those are the ones that I'd first try to eliminate. And then go more for the whole fruits and whole vegetables.
Right. And you know what? Granola bars, I used to have a real bad habit with granola bars when I used to work because they're easy to take along.
Yeah.
And even the ones that were geared or marketed as being healthier, when I sat down and really started reading the ingredients, like I have this thing, if I can't pronounce the ingredient, I don't know what it is. I look at the sodium. Even in granola bars that are supposed to be organic, all natural, non-GMO, they have a lot of salt and fillers. And salt is considered natural, but we're really supposed to have very, 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 very little salt per day. And I just remember thinking, I ate one granola bar and that's like more than half of my sodium for the day. One granola bar. So I cut those out a long time ago.
Yep. So yeah, you're eliminating the added sugars and salt, like you said, and oftentimes added fat by eliminating processed foods. So that would be another recommendation that, you know, just kind of for people to be more mindful where are processed foods sneaking in and what can you do to swap it out for something that's less processed, like fruits and vegetables. Okay, number four, I wanted people to be more mindful about their drinks. You know, we in this country in general consume a ton of sugar every day in our drinks. And they can be, you know, even maybe the more healthy drinks like tea is often loaded with sugar, and juice has too much added sugar in it. So I would like people to step back and kind of think about what they're drinking, and it kind of adds up, you know. Even if you're only having one soda a day, that's still a lot of sugar. And then if you do that 365 days a year, what is that adding up to be? So just mindful of that. And I would definitely recommend swapping it with water, or the sparkling waters nowadays have a bazillion different flavors. So that's good. And or tea, you know, depending on when you're listening to this, it's winter maybe, and a cup of tea is really good. And I love all the variety in the tea as well. So be mindful of your drinks and swap them out for water or tea.
All right. Simple. And one of the things is that it's better to make your tea at home than to buy the packaged or bottled tea. I always, like, if I were to go to a restaurant, I don't actually drink anything these days other than water and coffee. Because that's just one of my guilty pleasures and I like it. But even with the coffee creamer, I use like oat milk or coconut milk creamer. I use Truvia if I want to sweeten it. If I do a tea, like a hot tea, I use honey instead of sugar. I drink a lot of water. I used to have a really, really, really bad habit of drinking diet soda, and I cut it out of my life. So that was 2021. So that was like 8 years ago almost. Because I had IBS. Well, I still have it, but I have IBS. And I would drink diet soda, especially like when I was working. And although I wasn't getting all those extra sugar calories, there's all the other synthetic ingredients. And plus, it aggravated my IBS so bad, I ended up in the emergency room. And when they took like a CAT scan of my insides, like my intestines were like inflamed. And they were like, well, you have IBS. And we think that the amount of diet soda pop you're drinking is aggravating your medical condition. And I was in pain and miserable. And it was from that night on, it was just cold turkey. And if I try, even when I go to places like, because there are some types of ways to drink soda pop that's more natural. Like if I go to Amish country and they like do the root beer and they use like the real, like, I don't know what the underlining root is that they make to make root beer. I don't know the name of it. And I'll have just a little bit and just a tiny bit, like a quarter cup. And it's just like, oh, I wish I could, but I can't. Like I already start feeling it triggering my IBS symptoms. So that was enough for me to be like, nope. And it took a couple of weeks of adjusting because it was less caffeine. And my body was addicted to it. And I was going through withdrawal, but after about 3 weeks, it wasn't like I was like, like soda pop withdrawal. It wasn't like that, but they get some headaches because of the caffeine drop. And then my body trying to process out all the toxins that I'd been drinking. And I'm talking about, I was not just drinking like a 12 ounce of Diet Pepsi or Diet Coke. I was probably closer to three a day. Two or three every day, Monday through Friday. So it took a minute for my body to start readjusting as those toxins were being flushed out. And I haven't touched it since. And my IBS and like gut health overall, my stomach, it's better for it. And I'm so glad I had that metaphorical reality batch, like wake me up. So
yeah, very good. I'm glad it, I'm going to say healed you or helped you so much to, and to have that, to have you recognize that. That's awesome. Yeah. Good. Good. Number five, my next tip would be to just simply cook at home more. You know, we, as a society are eating out so much, and I think if people were able, and it kind of goes back to number one where I just said plan, you know, if you have something at home that you know I'm going to make such and such for dinner, then you're less likely to have to go out, you know, because you will have food at home that you want to prepare. So, but when people eat out, they're eating way more calories than they need. They're eating way more sodium than they need. They're eating way more fat than they need. And maybe sugar too, as well with the different drinks and stuff. So, so it's kind of a simple one, but also, you know, it kind of goes back to number one where you have to have a plan and know what you're going to be cooking, but just, depending on how many times a week people are eating out, evaluate that, and that can make a huge impact. I know, you know, when we all went through COVID and the kind of the lockdown that we had to endure, so many people did start eating at home more, and many of them became more healthy because of it, too. But then, you know, some of them, you know, have kind of, I would say, have gone right back. And I am always, always, always blown away at the lines that are wrapped around fast food restaurants.
Like
it will never cease to amaze me. The lines are absolutely wrapped around. So I just think they're, you know, there's always going to be a time for us as a society to try to eat more at home. So
yeah, I don't eat fast food either.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-mm. No. And I do see those lines like Chick-fil-A. I've never had Chick-fil-A and everyone says it's great. And I'm like, sure. I mean, I'm sure it smells great. I'll walk by and it's like aromatherapy in the air because I can smell it, but I've never had it because I'm like, at the end of the day, even if it's all white meat and chicken breast and all that stuff, it is still processed. It is still fried at one, you know, I know they have grilled, but Yeah, I don't eat fast food. I really don't even eat Subway, which if I were to make a choice, like I would kind of go more towards like a Subway where I can control what's on, like my sandwich. And I usually get a bit, like I would get a vegetarian, like twice a year I might get a Subway. And it's like a veggie, and it's like desperation. I'm starving, and it's the best option, which is like if I'm on the road, or stuck at an airport, that would be the option I would choose when it comes to, because people don't think it's fast food, but I'm like, it is. It is fast food because there are processed cheeses and all that, and it's delicious. I'm not denying it, but at the end of the day, I don't want to be traveling and then start having an upset stomach because I made like a poor on the road food choice, because there's nothing worse than inducing discomfort and then not being at home with what I put in my body. So.
So I guess that would be kind of what my recommendation though, is just to really try to eat more at home. And all right, and then my sixth tip is to be as consistent as possible with meal times, and then therefore also not try not to eat at night. I think of like me, for example. I have three kids, teenagers, and we have lots of activities at night. But in an ideal world, I would love to eat dinner every night at 5 o'clock, because I can say like at 5 o'clock I am hungry, and it would do me so well to eat then, and eat enough that I could just go all the way until the next morning. But with my kids' schedules, we sometimes have to eat a little later, 6:30, or sometimes even 7. But as much as possible, try to find meal times that are going to be good for your body, for your hunger levels, and then try not to eat too much in between meals. And especially that dinner, after dinner, in the evening, it's more so probably because of boredom. Or just, kind of as a final relaxation, let's kind of go out to the kitchen or the pantry and raid it one more time. But to be as consistent as possible and mindful about, meal times is going to be a simple but maybe a little complicated though too,
Right, because
but really
lifestyle,
significantly impact our health. I mean, I do think
yeah.
it's significant.
Our lifestyles and like you said, you have kids, or like if you're living with a chronic illness, it doesn't always, you're not saying that like do this, like be stringent, because we understand that these life circumstances can interfere with creating a scheduled nutritional lifestyle. And personally, I'm a grazer. I usually will like eat smaller meals like 4 to 6 times a day to keep my metabolism up. I prefer like a lot of people that here in the US, dinner's like the staple big meal. I'm kind of European in a lot of ways, especially Eastern European, where I like to have my bigger meal earlier in the day, because I just, as again, because I have fibromyalgia and because I have arthritis and IBS, I notice the impact more having such a heavier meal, even if I'm eating at 6 o'clock and I'm going to bed at 10. I don't know. And I feel that having that bigger meal for me personally, this is a personal choice that I make, but having that bigger, like staple meal, more like midday or like between 12 and 3, I feel like it really helps with my energy levels. And I also feel because I'm eating earlier, I'm a little bit more cognizant and I'm not desperate and being like, I'm so hungry, I'm just going to order pizza. Or I'm so hungry, I'm going to make mac and cheese. I found that kind of, that, like I said, this is what works for me. Our bodies and metabolisms are like thumbprints. While we all have one, they're all unique in what works for us. And that's something that I found works best with my body and my routine. And plus, then it does reduce that late night snacking, or it's running late and I missed the dinner time set and now it's 7 o'clock and I'm starving and I'm going to put anything in my mouth to alleviate that hunger. And I found for me that's a good hack that works. So I don't do late night snacking.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. So yeah, it's kind of like whatever is within reason, but I do think that, to me, it goes back to number one again, is just really planning and having the healthy things available, but also being mindful. Like I said, right now I'm in a stage of life where my kids kind of dictate my schedule, but I am telling you, as soon as they're out, I get to dictate my schedule. Mm-hmm. And so for those listeners that maybe don't have their schedule dictated by other things, you know, listen to your body and what your body needs, like you're saying too. Listen to your body and what your body needs and feed it well, based on what it needs. And not all these other little external things and temptations or boredom or whatever, you know, all that.
Yeah. But it's okay to indulge every once in a while, but modification's the key.
Yes. Yes, for sure. Yes. Yep. All right. And then last but not least, I just have find alternatives, and this kind of goes in the other one, but find alternatives to the different things that are our weaknesses. So like I mentioned before, like if soda is a weakness, what is an alternative to that? Or if having a bowl of ice cream every night is a weakness, what is an alternative to that? Or if having cookies or chocolates or whatever sweet every afternoon at 3 p.m., what is an alternative to that? So figure out what your weakness is, or think about what is your weakness and what would be some alternatives to that. So, as I mentioned ice cream, I used to be a huge ice cream lover. And what I have become a huge fan of now is I make ice cream out of frozen bananas. So I just put frozen banana slices in a little mini food processor, one spoonful of cocoa powder, and a little bit of plant milk. I have usually soy milk on hand, and I blend that up, and it literally tastes like soft serve ice cream, and it is three ingredients, the frozen bananas, cocoa powder, and a little plant milk. So awesome indulgence, but totally healthy. So finding alternatives for different things is what I would say is just, you know, and this is going to be, again, very personalized to people. But find what your weakness is and then think about what you can substitute instead and still be happy.
Right. And I love chocolate, but, you know, and I actually choose dark chocolate. I'm kind of like, is this something I could give up? And it's like, no, but I'm going to go with dark chocolate just because it's healthier. You know, there's more antioxidants. There's usually less sugar. I try to get European chocolate as well because they have less additives and sugar than Americanized chocolate. So that was a big thing that I changed, and it's not necessarily a very dramatic change. It's just a small modification where I can still kind of indulge, at least know like, this is one of those moments I treat myself, but at least it's not as bad as milk chocolate.
Yeah, it's good. I mean, there is the antioxidants and stuff that are in dark chocolate. So it's good. Yep. And I tell my clients to try to get the ones that say the 70% or higher, like 72, 80, sometimes 90, even, you know, the ones that are above 70 are the ones that you're looking for, because then they're going to have less sugar and less added fat.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I tried 95 before. That is a bit bitter. And I'm like 95, dark cocoa chocolate. And I was like, that's a bit bitter. But still, so I was like, well, I actually ended up grating that and mixing it with coconut milk and a little bit of Truvia to make hot chocolate.
Okay.
So that way I didn't end up wasting, because I thought I'd give it a try. And I was like, oh, that's a bit bitter. So that's kind of how I hacked that.
There you go. Yeah. That's good. Yep. All right. So those were my 7 tips for that.
And those are great tips, and a lot of times I think I know a lot of that stuff, but I forget, and it's just such a nice reminder, because I'll be like, oh yeah, I didn't think about that, or I forgot about that, or yeah, I can do that simple stuff. Now, we kind of already touched upon this, just with some of the things that you've already shared and my experiences with different foods, like soda pop. That isn't really a food. It is what it is. But what are some, just, you know, some examples of nutritional choices that help support our overall immune system?
Yeah. So, yes, I'm so glad that you're asking about this. I really think of our immune system as starting in the gut, and because it is in our gut where we have like 70%, they say about 70% of our immune system is in our gut. So then as a dietitian, you know that it's very important for me to help people nourish their gut as to the, you know, to the degree that they're able to. And that then will, you know, increase their immune health and also decrease their inflammation, which are really, they do kind of go hand in hand. So the immune system really starts in the gut, and that's why a nutritious diet is so important. So and I can kind of get into the science, but I don't really want to today. I just want to quick say that there, when we have a healthy gut and all those good bacteria, they produce something that's called short chain fatty acids. And short chain fatty acids are amazing, and our immune system wants them. And the more that we can produce, the healthier that we're going to be. So we want short chain fatty acids, and they kind of act as a coolant to our immune system, and they keep it cooled off. And we want our immune system and our the inflammation to be cooled off. So that's from the dietitian standpoint, science standpoint, that's what my goal is to really help people have a good, well-nourished gut and to really increase those short-chain fatty acids. So in no particular order here, I have about six. Now I have six different kind of categories of foods and things to think about. So in our last little section here that we just talked about, the number one thing I want people to think about when you're striving to get a healthy gut, I want people to lower, again, like all those processed foods. And in doing so, you're going to decrease that all the fat that typical Americans get in our diets. We'll also lower the sugar that typical Americans get in our diets. And then by cutting those out and by eating more real foods, I'm going to say, or whole foods, plants in particular, will be increasing our fiber. Okay. So that's kind of my first thing, is to cut back on the processed foods, the fats and the sugars, and increase fiber. So that's kind of my first tip to support a really healthy immune system. And then number two, the category of food that's really good is cruciferous vegetables. Again, this is kind of no particular order, but the cabbage, broccoli, kale, cauliflower. I personally put kale in my smoothies right away in the morning, so I'm kind of getting it right there. Broccoli and cauliflower are, you know, I'm going to say relatively easy to get. I prefer to use fresh cauliflower and broccoli, but you can get it frozen as well. I know that it's more nutritious and it retains more nutrients if you do not cook it to smithereens, is what I say. So just lightly, lightly cook your broccoli and your cauliflower, or eat it raw, even better. But sometimes, you know, it's a little more tolerated. Preferred to cook it a little bit. But when I put it in stir fries or soups, I put it in at the very end of cooking time because I don't want my broccoli and cauliflower to get cooked to smithereens, that's how I say it. Cabbage is really amazing for us, and I love to make different salads and throw in a little bit of like shredded cabbage, okay? Or soups too, you know, all these different soups. So cruciferous vegetables are amazing. And then number three, I would say another thing to boost our immune system is fruit. And I would definitely recommend eating whole fruit as much as possible, not fruit juice. And with your budget, you maybe prefer frozen fruit, especially berries are amazing. So, and berries sometimes can get expensive if you buy them fresh. So sometimes it might be more economical to buy them frozen. Otherwise, apples are good. I definitely recommend buying organic apples if you're able to, because I want you to eat the peel. There's a lot of nutrition in the peel of apples. So I would recommend trying to buy organic if possible. Oranges are awesome.
I do have a question, like for myself, I have IBS. So like apples, I mean, I used to take apples to work like almost every day, but now with IBS, that's one of my trigger foods that
not working.
That brings me down. So is there something similar to an apple that would get almost the same benefits that's in the peel of the apple, another fruit that I could substitute that wouldn't?
I think grapes are awesome too, and there's a lot of nutrition in their peels. But then all the there's a lot of vegetables too, but grapes are good. And then I really like berries, and right now oranges are so good. You know, in the winter time, oranges are so good, depending on when people are listening to this. But otherwise it's fun to try some of the more, or the, I would say less common fruits. I mean, there's some fun ones out there. I'm just kind of thinking of kiwi, pears. Pears are good. Especially when they're seasonal and ripe. Oh, there's nothing like a good pear. So just get variety. I encourage people to get variety, but there is probably the most highly nutritious fruits are the berries. And I think one of the easiest ways and most economical is to get them frozen.
And so I do have a question.
Yes.
True or false? I've always have been taught that the more colorful the fruit or vegetable, it's typically more nutritious for you.
I would say in general, that's totally true. Yes. Yep.
So
yep.
If I was going to choose between, let's say, trying to think of two things, like celery or a red bell pepper.
Yeah, probably bell pepper. Yep. Yep.
So if you're not on the up and up, that could be a little tool or, you know, idea to use when you are picking out fruits and vegetables, whether fresh or frozen, is that it's an idea. It doesn't mean it applies all the time, but a lot of the times, the more colorful, it's typically has more nutrients and vitamins.
Yes. One really simple thing to would be, and I am, I think, let's see. Nope, I guess I'm not doing it here. But when I look at greens, like if you're looking of like iceberg lettuce or spinach, get the spinach. It's way more colorful, you know, or kale, get the kale. It's way more colorful than iceberg lettuce. So yes, the darker greens are amazing colors. The oranges and the reds and the purples, for sure. Very good. Very good choices if you can get those deep colors. Likely going to have more nutrition. Yep. Even something simple and it's not a big deal, but red grapes have a little more nutrition than green grapes, you know? So, you know, just something simple like that. But I still, my daughter, I think I went through a spell where I like quit buying green grapes. And then my daughter was like, Mom, I like green grapes. And I was like, oh, okay. So I started buying them again. But there's nothing wrong with green grapes. Green grapes are really good. Go for variety as much as possible. Yep. All right. Then my fourth one is I would swap out all these heavy, higher fat meat items for more legumes. Kristal mentioned before, I am a dietitian that definitely encourages a more plant-based lifestyle. And so when possible, try some of these beans or legumes. So I love different kinds of soups with beans. Even stir fries or curry dishes are amazing to put beans into. We eat a lot of Mexican dishes around here. So those are really simple dishes you can have. Just last night I smashed black beans And then I added the fajita bell peppers and I rolled up the tortillas and I put them in my air fryer. So we made like rolled up tostadas or would you say taquitos?
I don't know, but it sounds
really good. My whole family was really happy and there was no meat involved. So just using legumes, lentils, you know, different beans are going to be really supportive of your immune system. And if you're not used to eating beans quite yet, go slow, but just kind of keep at it. Your gut will get adjusted. If you first start eating them, your gut will react and be like, whoa, what just happened? And they'll create, you know, maybe gas and stuff like that. But don't give up. Just keep eating it a little bit at a time and you can gradually eat more and more beans. But beans are going to be so healthy to, in the long term, improving your gut health.
And I was going to say, I do, like, I'll make dishes. It is a staple, but I try to make it more plant-based than meat-based is I'll make chili. And I use three kinds of beans. I use black beans, kidney beans, and navy beans, which are like the yellow beans. And I use a lot more vegetables. I'll use like the green pepper and yellow peppers in there. And what happens is it's like really my chili is about 2/3 plant-based. And I'm putting in the variety of beans. And I don't know, it's like one of my favorite meals. And then I'm like, it's more, you know, vegetable heavy. And one of the things is like the peppers and stuff, I'll throw that in last so that they don't get mushy.
Yes. Yeah. Good. Yeah. Chili is a dish that can really, I would say, easily be made plant-based. Mm-hmm. And with all those beans. Yeah. And like you're saying, a variety of different beans, different vegetables. Yeah. Very good. Yep. So, I, in the legume category, I do recommend soy as well. So like whole would be the edamames. And I like to put those in different salads, or tofu. I love to cube it and I put it in my air fryer and then I throw that in different stir fries or, curry dishes. And then tempeh is the less processed soybean fermented. And so that would be in there as well. So otherwise lentils are the easiest bean to cook. They take less than 20 minutes. You can throw lentils into a pot of soup and in less than 20 minutes, they'll be cooked up. So the other thing, you know, right now meat is a little more expensive than we're used to paying for it. And so if you can substitute these legumes, you can ultimately save money too. So that's another they're more nutritious and you can save money. So win-win.
It is. I'm all about saving money. I like design on a dime in every category of my life, including food. So,
right? Yay. Yes. All right. My fifth tip is the omega-3s to increase our immune system. So I'm a big proponent of using ground flax seeds. So I typically put them in my smoothies in the morning. I also love to do hemp seeds. And on the days when I have oatmeal, I always top my oatmeal with hemp seeds, or you can put hemp seeds on a salad or avocado toast or something like that. And then also I love to make chia pudding. So the chia seeds and some plant milk, a little cocoa powder, or any flavor of chia pudding, but chia pudding is a fun dessert to have without all the added preservatives and all the added sugar as well. So
I haven't tried chia pudding yet, but another one that I have tried that I'm like, oh, is coconut pudding.
Okay.
Have you ever had it?
No. So does it use the coconut?
I'm not talking about instant stuff. Talking about, and you can make it with coconut milk because it thickens, but I was just like, where have you been my whole life? Because I'm not a huge pudding person, and I'm weird about coconut. I want artificial coconut, or even though it's from coconut and it's shredded, and I can't stand that stuff. It's gross, but I'll eat fresh coconut or the coconut milk, and I was just, amazed, and I feel like the chia seed idea is something I can incorporate in my coconut pudding.
Yes. Well. Yes. So, yes. Yes. And for the longest time, I would just do the plant milk and the chia seeds. And then so the consistency would be like tapioca pudding. But mm-hmm. recently, I've been putting my chia pudding into my high-powered little blender. And therefore, then it thickens up and it's not not like the tapioca consistency anymore. It's more smooth. So you can do that too with the chia seed pudding. So it is smooth as well.
That's a great tip.
And a lot of people,
they're weird about texture. So that's why I think that's a great tip that's a way. I do know some people are like, I know chia is good for me. I don't like the That's a great tip.
Fix the blender. Yep. And then the other thing I was going to say is a lot of people eat chia pudding for breakfast too. So you load it up with different fruits and it can be breakfast. Chia pudding. Yep. Kind of like overnight oats. You have overnight chia.
That's a great idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like having dessert for breakfast.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. And you can, again, load it up with the different fruit and maybe nuts as well. So nuts are a good source of omega-3s. Walnuts are really good. Almonds. But I would recommend eating them as much as possible in their natural form. So raw, or if they're roasted, I would not recommend all the salt and all that other stuff, because that's just really going to add the sodium content. And mm-hmm. I want people to learn how to enjoy the natural state of food and adjust their taste buds more so to enjoying the natural state of food. So, but those omega-3 sources are really good for our immune health. And And then last but not least here, my other tip for boosting our immune system would be to get whole grains. And so for some people, maybe you want to do more of the gluten-free grains. That's okay. Like I've talked about oatmeal a few times today. I like to eat the Ezekiel-type bread or sprouted grain bread. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, brown rice, barley, bulgur, millet, farro, all these different whole grains provide us with so many nutrients. And nowadays there's a lot of variety available, even at, I'm going to say, regular grocery stores. You know, you don't have to go to a health food store. A lot of these whole grains are available right at a regular grocery store. So, And then it just add them. They become the they complement then different roasted vegetables, or you can put them into soups, throw that barley into a vegetable soup and it adds more protein and fiber. Quinoa is another one that I kind of would put into this category as well. So quinoa is super easy. Quinoa is super easy. And I love tricolor quinoa. It's so pretty. It's expensive. It's more expensive, but to me, it's worth it because it's so beautiful. And I want my food to be beautiful too, for sure.
I have found that at stores like Aldi's, Save a Lot now. It's this more regional to me, but like Mark's. But I have been finding that at our stores that are more cost effective, like your Aldi's and Save a Lot. So that's one of the things that's nice, because you said before, a lot of this stuff, it was you're going to your more higher end grocery stores or health food stores to find it. And now I'm seeing it at Walmart, I'm seeing it at Target, I'm seeing it at Aldi's, and it's becoming more cost effective. I remember back in the day, 20 years ago, brown rice was super expensive. Now it's not as expensive as it used to be. So, and I think part of the reason is because it's becoming more readily available and we're finding it at a variety of stores, and those stores that tend to be more cost effective for people who are on a budget. So the next time you're at Walmart or Aldi's or Target has their own brand that's less expensive with these different suggestions that are being made that you can try. I also like purple rice as well. That is a little bit more expensive. I can find it on Amazon for less money than at any of the stores, maybe by a couple dollars. But purple rice is one of those. It's like back in the day in the Chinese Empire, it was considered like a delicatessen. It was for the royals, and it has a lot of antioxidants and stuff. And I I'm not a huge rice person, but that I can eat. I love it. And it tastes different, even though it's rice consistency. So those are some things that I'm like, since I don't eat rice a lot and I can buy for, it's not like bulk, like 5 pounds, but a bigger package of purple rice that will last me for like a year. And so when I am going to have rice, I'm going to have my favorite rice.
That's good. And I'm sure there's more antioxidants and stuff in that as well because of that deep color.
It's just delicious. That's why I like it. I like it better than like white rice and even brown rice. So now real quick, as we're going to be wrapping up here shortly, I wanted to ask you, what are kind of like the three major no-go foods that tend to trigger inflammation in the body? If we could, like the three worst, like foods that really trigger inflammation in the body. And if we know what those bad guys are, then we can at least, if not eliminate it, reduce it or modify it or substitute it. Like, what would you say are the three top that are really bad?
Well, I would first say it's going to be the processed foods. So we kind of touched on it already, but it's all those convenience foods and packages that are so easy. They're really nowadays very economical and they just, you know, call our names. So it's all that, those processed foods, because they're going to be higher in sugar and fat. And then the other thing that I would say is really going to be inflammatory to us is really the meat products and all the dairy products. Like I said before, I am kind of one on the, where I recommend more plants to decrease inflammation. So there's a lot of scientific evidence that encourage people to decrease their animal products. Mm-hmm. And that is meat and dairy and even fish to eliminate or to cut back on inflammation. So, to the degree that somebody wants to, if you don't want to go 100% vegan, that's okay. But just think about where you can make substitutions and eat more plant-based.
Right. So if someone's eating steak 4 times a week, let's try substituting that with like something else.
Yes.
And that way you bring it down to 3 times a week. You know, it's all those small steps that seem to trigger big changes, and then it tends to motivate us to look at other simple things that we could substitute or modify. I think that once you start the process, then it leads to you modifying or substituting other things down the road. Just my personal experience. Yes. I mean, that's for me, but.
Yeah, no, I think you're totally right, because I think once people realize their success, you know, a little bit here, then they're going to try go for a little more. And then it just, you know, it's kind of like a positive domino effect where you just kind of keep seeing little success and you'll keep going. So, you know, one of the popular things is Meatless Monday. All right. Yeah. Let's start with Meatless Monday and now maybe have a Meatless Thursday, you know, too, have 2 days a week or 3 days a week. But that's what I would say. And then another big one would be alcohol. And depending on people's consumption of that, I would definitely be mindful of the consumption and either eliminate it or really, really cut it back, because that too is going to cause so much havoc in your gut. And your gut is where it really is at for your immune system and your inflammation as well.
So for myself, I don't really drink alcohol a lot, but special occasions like my birthday or holidays, maybe a wedding, you know, every once in a while. I mean, I really could count on one hand how many times I will have an alcoholic beverage. So if I was to celebrate, let's say, my birthday or another special occasion, and I am going to choose to consume an alcoholic beverage, what would be a better choice over another one? So what if I, you know, like beer? Maybe you're like, is that a bad one? And would I be better off having wine versus beer? Or would I be better off having like, I don't know, more like a martini versus a frou-frou drink that has all those fancy things in it that, and Yeah. So, like, is there an idea that if we are going to make that choice once in a blue moon, that there's a better choice, even though it's still bad, it's not as bad as the first choice?
Yeah. I think in general, if you're consuming drinks only a few a year, I would say you drink what you want to drink. Okay. You know, what is the one that you really truly want? I would go for it. When there is a couple plant-based authors though that do they do give a thumb up to like red wine, because there is some of the antioxidants in the red grapes, like we were talking about earlier. Mm-hmm. So there has been a little bit, there is maybe a little nutrition more so in wine. And you think of the country of Italy and that Mediterranean region where it is consumed mm-hmm. more, they do tend to have or had had in the past a longer life expectancy too.
That's really is everyone with this discussion is looking at what little hacks you could do to promote your overall immune system and health and reduce, you know, triggering information through our food choices to the best of your ability. And if you're limited in on, like, you can't go and buy like 10 fruits a week, it's out of your budget, or you're going to only be able to afford 2 or 3 fruits, for example, choosing the ones that have the more nutritional value and get you the more bang for your buck, for lack of a better way of saying it. So, well, Joy, I thank you for your wealth of knowledge and sharing your time and being willing to share with my audience and anyone else who ends up tuning in your insight and expertise. And if anyone is interested in learning more, they can visit your website called Bring Joy to Your Kitchen. And with that said, if you found this informational video helpful, please like and share. And until next time, make your self-care your number one priority. Love yourselves and love each other. You gotta get bruised before you get mad. You gotta fall down before you fight back. Was feeling so weak, but baby, I'm strong. Little did I know I'm a champion. I'm a champion.
Champion.